Good morning, welcome to Lifehouse. Let's sing together.
And in our time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, and there is only one foundation, we believe, we believe. And in this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see, and there is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and that He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered. And that He's coming back again.
Let our faith,
so let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. Weakness and temptations, we believe, we believe, we believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father.
Y'all believe that? Say, uh-huh. Yeah, man. We serve an awesome God who's alive and well, and He loves you so much. I hope you are ready to just receive this morning. We've got just an awesome service planned, and the Spirit of the Lord is here, and the Word of God says when that happens, there is freedom. Amen? So we're glad you guys are here. My name is Rob Light. I'm the worship pastor. And if this is your very first time, next hour and 10 minutes or so, we're going to do some more music. We're going to open up the Word of God. We're going to dive in today. And I hope you've come ready to receive. It's going to be a great day in the Lord, I promise you. And hope you feel welcome today. For those of you who are regular attenders and partners, welcome back to church. Thank goodness that the hurricane took a right? Yeah, right. But that was really cheesy, sorry. Hey, turn around, find two people you haven't met with and talked with today, and welcome them to Lifehouse Church. We're glad you guys are here. Hey, as you're finding your way back to your seat, if you don't mind, to just squish in the middle a little bit and leave up some open seats on the aisle. We got some late guests coming in, and let's check out this week's announcement video. You can be seated.
Our next baby dedication service is on October 11th. If you'd like to have your child dedicated, please see one of the pastors or email us at info@lifehousede.com.
Lifehouse 101 is an opportunity for the staff to share with you God's vision for the church. If you are interested in partnering or if you have questions, this class is for you. Join us today in room 118 following the 10:45 service. Lunch and childcare will be provided. If you have attended a Lifehouse 101 meeting and you feel God leading you to be a part of what He is doing in and through Lifehouse Church, you will have the opportunity to express that decision at the close of service next Sunday. We look forward to welcoming you to the Lifehouse family and are excited to see what God will do as we partner in ministry together.
We've been enjoying some amazing studies here on Tuesday nights at Lifehouse, and we're gearing up for another great study for men and women called Gods at War. In this study, we'll address the fact that there are gods at war within each of us. They battle for the throne of our hearts, and much is at stake. In our sessions together, we'll learn how to give God His rightful place on the throne of our hearts. It's starting Tuesday night, October 13th at 6:30, and as always, there'll be something for all ages. I hope you'll join us.
If you would like to know more about these events or others,
download the Lifehouse app, check out our Facebook page, or visit lifehousede.com.
We hope you take these opportunities to connect, grow, and serve.
His love endures forever. So sing praise with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. And sing praise. Into the setting sun, His love endures forever, and by the grace of God we will carry on. His love endures forever. And sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. sing that. Forever, God is faithful. Forever, God is strong. Forever, God is with us. Forever, never. Help him out, come on. Repeat after me. His love endures forever. Sing it.
His love endures forever.
His love endures forever.
Come on. His love endures forever.
Sing it out.
His love endures forever.
Last time now. Sing praise,
sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise.
Forever you are,
forever you are faithful, forever you are strong, forever you are with us, forever. Never, yeah, forever you are faithful. Forever you are strong, yeah. Forever you are with us now. Forever and never. Sing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. If you're reading through Psalms with the Bible reading team this year, trying to make it through the Bible in 1 year and pay attention the whole time. I don't know if you're like me. I'll be reading, and I'm like, well, what? I'll have to go back like 3 pages because my mind just wanders. It's crazy. But if you are following this plan, we're in Psalms, and it's filled with that. His love endures forever. It's all throughout there. David writes. And I'm just, it kind of goes with that song. And I don't know if you have burdens this morning. Maybe you're not human if you don't. But we all have burdens. We all have something going on. And it might just be something like stress. Man, I'm stressed out. I can't think, you know. Or maybe it's huge. Maybe there's a health issue or something major. You just lost your job. I know there's folks in here that have burdened souls this morning. So we all relate. We're all in the same boat, right? But my challenge is to just give those burdens to the Lord. I want to read Psalm 55:22. It says, and you can read it with me. It says, give your burdens to the Lord, and he will take care of you. He will not permit the godly to slip and fall. That comes out of Psalms 55. And, you know, that basically says you can walk away today. You can walk away from your shame. You can walk away from your guilt. You know, as we worship, it's important for us to give that over. Or else it's not real worship if we're not really focused on what we're doing. I don't know if you're like this, but when my kids come in, when they're scared and they're afraid and they've got burdens, you know, and they crawl up in your lap, especially when they're little, and girls, oh, ever since I had a girl, I cry like every 2 seconds. But something about girls, right? When they crawl up in your lap, Daddy, I'm afraid that boogeyman, he's in their closet. There is no boogeyman, okay? But I know you guys think there is, but there's not, so you don't have to be afraid. But anyway, when you're talking to them about that, and you just give them that, you can hear them breathe, like, and to give that fear over to you. So everybody in this room right now, whatever your fear is, whatever your burden is, let's take that deep breath. Ready? Feels better, huh? That's what God is for us. He wants us to come, and he wants us to give him our burdens. Cage did an awesome job last week leading a new song, and there's a line in that song that just stuck out to me, and it says, "All fear removed, I breathe you in and lean into your love." And I kind of pictured myself leaning into his arms, that deep breath. So whatever's going on this morning, just challenge you just to let it go. God said, give me your burdens, cast your burdens on me, because I care for you, and he can take them this morning. So let's give our burdens to the Lord today. Know that he loves you, and let's worship.
In the grace so relentless, I am won by perfect love. Wrapped within the arms of heaven, in a peace that lasts forever, sinking deep in mercy, see, I'm wide awake, drawing close, stirred by grace, and all my heart is yours. All fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Glory, Lord of all, so beautiful. Here in you I find shelter, captivated by the splendor of your face, my secret place. I'm wide awake, drawing close, stirred by grace, and oh, my heart is yours. All fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love.
Sing it to him.
Your love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I see. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. Your love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I see. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. I'm wide awake, all fear removed, I breathe.
into your arms. Oh, your so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I see. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. Your love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I see. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Pour in my only cry to know you all my life. Your love so deep is washing.
You are so good to us. Think about the reasons right now why you believe that. And don't think about the things that you see and feel every day. Think about what He's done for you. Think about the depth that He went to rescue you. If you're here today and you don't know Him as a Father, as a Savior, as your rescuer, I can promise you He can do it. He can change you. God, we surrender ourselves to you, God. Lord, speak to hearts today, Lord, that we'd receive your word, your truth directly, Lord, that we can apply it. God, we love you. Thank you for just being here and meeting us today. Thank you for a new day that we can breathe. May you be blessed today. Take burdens away, Lord. Take our worries, our stress, our problems, the things that get in the way and that just make so much noise in our lives we can't even hear your still small voice. Lord, we give those things to you. Lord, hear our prayers. You could be seated. Been a good morning so far. We haven't even started. It's going to be a good day. Again, if this is your very first time to Lifehouse Church, we're so glad you guys are here. Thank you for coming. I hope you feel welcome. I know there's a bunch of churches in our area that preach the Bible, good churches, and we're blessed that you would you'd come out today. So I hope you feel welcome. Before you leave, don't forget to come by the Connect table in the lobby. We have a free gift for you and your family, so please take advantage of that. Also, ushers are coming forward. They have a little card for you. If you wouldn't mind filling that out, we'd like to see who's here. It's kind of really tough in that little tiny lobby to meet everybody, but this is kind of a way just to make this big room smaller. So this week, one of our pastors will call you, and if you don't want us to call you, then don't put the phone number down, okay? Just put your email, at least your email. That way we can email you, because I know that's less intrusive sometimes. Up here in the north, we don't want anyone to know our business, you know. Come to the door, forget it, get the gun out, right? Oh, no. No. We're in the north. We don't believe in that, right? Anyway, let's not go there. Hey, Dave. I know Dave's got some guns. He was hunting yesterday, telling us the big stories. But anyway, and I got ADD, so where are we? Okay. So if you're a guest, why don't you raise your hand? Keep your hands up. Get one of these cards. Lifehouse Church, let's welcome these guys to church. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Good morning, church. I've got a question. Can you honestly say that Jesus Christ is your one desire, as we sang in that song? Well, if you don't know me, my name is Drew Matthews, and I'm a partner here at Lifehouse Church. And this is the time of our service where we worship God through giving. If you're traditional, you can give your offering, as the ushers will come forward in just a moment as we pass the baskets. But if you're tech savvy, if you're part of that new generation, you can actually give online, and you can actually text to give. And as of yesterday, I don't know how many of you have seen the commercial, the Domino's commercial, you can text an emoji of a pizza slice and order pizza that way. Mm-hmm. We're not quite there yet, but it's tough to keep up with all these this technology. But anyway, in all seriousness, one of the things that we often say at Lifehouse Church is that salvation is not a destination. Salvation is just the beginning of your journey with Jesus Christ into his image. That is the will. That is God's will, according to Romans 8:29. So as followers of Christ, whether you know it or not, not only are you on a journey, a spiritual journey, you're also on a generosity journey. Because as you're being transformed into the image of Christ, as you're growing, it's inevitable that you're going to become more generous, because that's the heart of our Heavenly Father. So over the course of the next 8 weeks, as we start a new sermon series today called The Generosity Journey, we're going to have some of our Lifehouse partners share their testimony, share their stories of generosity. And I'm going to invite you to watch one of those right now.
I think it was, we started giving at our previous church. We didn't really give regularly, it was pretty sporadic. I don't think it was until probably about 2 or 3 years ago, when Gina went to one of the Tuesday night Bible study and just came home and just felt really convicted that this was something that we need to do on a regular basis.
So when I came home from the Bible study, I just really just felt convicted that God had put it on my heart that we needed to tithe, and we needed to tithe first. We're biblically called to do that. So I just really felt that we had been Christians for a long time, but we weren't following that biblical principle. So we needed to commit to that as a family.
So I think for me, when we started talking about it, you know, it really wasn't about the money. It wasn't about the time. It was about what was in our heart that God really wanted. It's great that we give our money, but really what God wants is our heart, and why, and that's why we should be giving.
Giving is a priority to us because we have seen the outcomes from it. We've seen the fruits. At first, we both went out on a leap of faith, and God was really faithful right away. And he has been so faithful to us. Like I said earlier, our income has drastically changed, but somehow we always have enough money. We're not really sure how it happens, but somehow God always provides for the things that we need.
So what we learned is generosity is not something God wants from us.
It's something he wants for us.
Amen. That's awesome. God is faithful. And I just want you to think about, before we pray for the offering, if you're a follower of Christ, you're being transformed into his image. And if that's the case, then you should be growing in your generosity. And Pastor Mark's going to preach an awesome sermon shortly after this. So let's go ahead and pray. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We look to you, God, because you are the author of generosity, God. Lord, you gave your son Jesus Christ to die for us, God. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it, God, and we can't even pay you back. You pour your grace and your mercy out on us, God. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that as we're being transformed into your image, Lord, that our hearts would become like yours and that we would grow in generosity. Lord, I pray as we give today, as we give of our tithes and our offerings, Lord, I just pray that you would be pleased. Lord, I pray that it would be a form of worship to you because you are the one true God and the only God. And you alone are to be worshiped. We love you. We praise you. We worship you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Covered in sin and shame, I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the sun away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Amen.
Bye. Lifehouse Church, thank you. I hope you see those testimonies. Many of those testimonies are because of your willingness to invest in the kingdom of God, because you are willing to show up on Sunday mornings at 7 o'clock and serve in these children's rooms and share the gospel and live out your faith. Thank you for being on mission. And thank all of you. I think it was 35 men and women and children who publicly declared their faith, saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. Amen. At this time, I'd like to dismiss. I almost got so caught up in the emotion, I almost forgot. Junior high and high school students, 6th through 12th grade students, if you want to follow Pastor Kent to the gym, that's an option for you to come. He's going to preach the word there, and you'll have a good time in the Lord together there. The rest of you, wow, that baptism celebration video is so awesome. And that will be posted online, and also we'll have pictures available to those who participated next week. I encourage you to share those photos and those videos on social media, whatever opportunity you have with your friends and family, because that declaration that you made, that testimony, God can continue using that testimony. If you've not been baptized by immersion as a believer, be watching. The next one we'll have will probably be in a couple months. I encourage you to find out more about what that's about. If you have any questions about that, please email us, talk to us so that we can share with you why we believe it's so important. Lifehouse Church, all right, this morning we are going to, for the next 8 weeks, pause our journey verse by verse through the Apostle Paul's letter to Roman believers to embark on another journey, an important journey, a journey of generosity, as Drew has already shared. And eventually, Lord willing, we'll make our way back to Romans and we'll pick up right where we left off. But again this morning, we as a congregation are going to begin a new journey, a journey of generosity. And we're calling it a journey specifically because it is our hope and our prayer and our burden that when all is said and done, at the end of this 8-week journey, we will all, as individuals and a church family, corporately be in a different place, in a better, God-glorifying place, specifically in regards to generosity. We have some neat things planned. Drew has already shared some of the things that we're going to be doing. Each of our elders, Rob even, who our worship leader, is going to be preaching a sermon, and the others specifically on the topic of generosity. One of the most exciting things that we're going to be doing, and I'll encourage you right now to mark your calendars for November 8th. So 5 weeks from Sunday, this Sunday, we are going to have what we're calling, we don't know what else to call it, but a reverse offering. And what we're going to do, instead of receiving our normal tithes and offerings like we do every week, just like we did this morning, that week every penny collected will be divided evenly between our life groups, the college group, the 1021 group, the youth group, even the children's ministry. And we're going to split that offering up and charge these groups to go out into our community and show generosity for the glory of God. It's going to be awesome in a creative way. And I'm praying and I'm asking you to pray with me that that offering, November 8th, mark your calendars, will be by far the largest offering that we've ever received. I want God to be glorified. So pray with me. Every man, woman, boy, girl, college student, high school student, I'm asking you to pray how the Lord would lead you to participate, especially on that day. If you don't normally give, I'm asking you to consider giving that Sunday. If you give sporadically or regularly even, I'm asking you to consider giving even more that Sunday. Even if you tithe, I'm asking you to tithe that Sunday, but even pray about going beyond your tithe and giving an offering to the Lord that Sunday. Again, every penny will go to be split amongst these groups, you, and taken out into our community for the glory of God. Reverse offering. That week, we're going to celebrate. Rob's going to have a praise choir, so if you're interested in that, be looking for those announcements. We're really going to celebrate and praise God for the work that he's not only going to do through us, but also in us for his glory, for taking us, each and every one of us, higher with him and building his kingdom. And you may be this morning asking why. Why the pause in the letter to Romans? Why? What's this journey of generosity all about? What's their motivation? You may be thinking, if you're visiting here this morning, or if you're a new believer, or maybe even a mature believer, you may be thinking, oh, here it goes, the church, begging for money. I knew it. That's what the church is supposed to do. I knew it. They wanted my money. And if that's you this morning, I'm telling you, you're wrong. Generosity is something that God wants for you. Each and every one of you is his children. and that we, as his servants for that matter, want for you, for his kingdom. And so the message this morning specifically as we begin this generosity journey, it's a charge to continue. As believers, to continue following Jesus, to continue growing in our faith, to continue experience God in ways that we have not before for his glory and our good. So I invite you to turn to the book of Acts, chapter 2, and we're going to start in verse 41. This passage of scripture is so relevant in light of the video that was just shown as we watched the recap video of the baptism celebration from last week, where 35 men, women, and children publicly declared their saving faith in the Lord Jesus. Well, it's documented in Acts in these first two chapters that the same thing happened, but on a much larger scale, an exponentially greater scale, over 2,000 years ago in Jerusalem when the church began. Leading up to this verse, the Apostle Peter preached his first sermon. He preached the gospel. He boldly preached the gospel, the good news of Jesus, and he declared that because of Jesus and because of his death on the cross and his resurrection, that salvation is now available to men who were otherwise condemned in sin and because of sin. And incredibly, and it's documented there in Acts, thousands of people believed the gospel. Thousands of people accepted the message that Peter boldly declared. They responded in Acts 2:37. It says, now when they, the people, the crowds of people heard this, the gospel, they were cut to the heart, it says. And they, these people said to Peter, they responded and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? We believe, what shall we do? How shall we respond? And in verse 38, Peter said to them, repent and be baptized. Every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit will be born in your heart. And so in Acts chapter 2, verse 41, those who received Peter's word, his instructions to them, those who accepted the gospel were baptized. That's how they responded. They did what Peter told them to do, and there were added that day to the church about 3,000 souls. Can you imagine 3,000 souls, men and women, just like you and I here this morning, and children all repenting of their sins and turning to the Lord Jesus Christ and publicly and boldly declaring their faith in him for salvation? But as we see in the verses that follow, they didn't stop there. No, they continued. That's what this message is this morning, that we would be like these new believers, these converts. They continued. You'll see, they continued. May we continue. In our culture today, as Drew already mentioned, so many erroneously view saving faith, salvation, as a destination. It's not. Salvation is the beginning. When you are saved, you begin a relationship with God. You begin a journey with Jesus. You start to follow him. The Spirit of God is born in your heart, and from that point, you begin to grow in your faith, and you begin to live the life that he intended you to live, the abundant life. So many claim that salvation today, oh, I'm saved, I believe. But they hang out at the start line and they miss out. And if those people really assess their lives and relationship with God, they realize that they don't really have a relationship with God. And they may be on a journey, but it's not with Jesus. Brother and sister saved by grace through faith in Jesus, understand that Jesus doesn't follow us. We follow him. And the Spirit of God is born in our hearts for a specific purpose, to lead us, to guide us in all truth with and in Jesus Christ. He doesn't follow us. We follow him. And that's what we see in the verses that follow in Acts chapter 2. And in the lives of those who accepted the gospel and were baptized. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. No excuses, no justifications. They simply continued. In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, we're told that those people, each and every one of those people that were saved and baptized, those people then devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship. And furthermore, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Verse 43, and as they, those people did, all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all of those people, all who believed, were together, and they had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing, giving the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, a attending the temple together. All those people were breaking bread in their homes, and they were receiving their food with glad and generous hearts. They were all praising God continuously and having favor continuously with all the people, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. It was incredible. This is a true story. This happened. This is history. And it was no doubt exciting. And what I hope that we as the body of Christ, his church today, will see in this passage what strikes me, and I pray will strike each and every one of you and motivate all of us and inspire all of us, is that these believers, these converts, continued. They didn't stop at the start. They didn't wait a few years and then start. No, these converts continue to not haphazardly or arbitrarily or casually. No, you read this passage and you see that there was commitment. They were committed. In verse 42, we are told specifically that they devoted themselves. In other words, they were all in. They did, as new believers, exactly what Paul charges all believers, and as we've been studying believers to do in Romans 12:1, when Paul charges, he says, I appeal to you, I urge you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to offer your bodies, yourselves, devote yourselves, offer your bodies, be a sacrifice, a living sacrifice to God, holy and acceptable to God. This is your spiritual worship. These believers, these new believers, did just that. They devoted themselves. The believers continued, and they did so in community. And together, they were committed, devoted, specifically, we're told, to study the apostles' teaching. Listen, these people, they were just like you and me. Don't sensationalize these people. These were normal people. These were fathers and mothers and sisters and brothers, people with jobs. These were not super Christians. These were humble new believers. They knew that they did not know everything, and they likely still had many questions and had much yet to discover, but the thing is, they knew where to find the answers to those questions. And they sought diligently to answer those questions that they had. And so they devoted themselves specifically to answer those questions, to study the apostles' teaching. I assure you that as the apostles, Peter and the others who taught, as they taught these new believers, they weren't sugarcoating anything. I assure you. They were not watering anything down, and the believers, furthermore, didn't want them to water anything down. They wanted the truth. Do you want the truth? Do you want to hear what God has to say in his word? If you're a believer, you should. The apostles taught them the truth and nothing but the truth, God's word. And not just so they could know it, not just so that their minds could be filled up and they could be puffed up. No, so that they could live it out, God's word out, so that they could apply God's word to their lives, so that they could be changed by God's word for God's glory, but also for their good. These believers understood that God's word is God's word. And was therefore to them, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, profitable to them for everything, for teaching, for reproof, for correction and training in righteousness, that the man of God, that they, because they were children of God, men and women of God, that they may be complete and equipped for every good work. In other words, so that each and every one of them could do and be who God wanted them to be and do what God wanted them to do, called them to do. They continued. And they were also committed. You see in this passage, they devoted themselves. That's commitment to community. We're told specifically that they also devoted themselves to specifically the fellowship. Not just to God, Almighty God, when they devoted themselves and offered themselves. Not just to God's word, to truth, as they studied the apostles' teaching. We are told they devoted themselves to the fellowship, to one another. They knew that they needed each other. They knew that iron sharpens iron, that each of them had unique gifts that they were to use in conjunction, according to God's word, with others in their fellowship, their church. Now listen and understand. Again, these were real people, just like you and me, with problems, just like you and me. They were people that had anxieties and issues, just like us. And I'm sure there were many excuses brought up and many justifications brought up. But the reality is, whether it was 2,000 years ago in Jerusalem or today, here and now, when you put people in the mix, you put problems in the mix. It's a reality. Nevertheless, when these new believers continued, they were devoted to the fellowship in spite of that reality. And so should we be. The picture that we see here in Acts 2 of God's church as it began is a good picture. It's a picture that we as the church today and the people of God, believers today, should strive for. It's our example. It's the ideal. And despite the obvious challenge that these believers were faced with, they were committed, as in devoted to, the fellowship and the breaking of bread and the prayers. These converts continued. And they were committed and they continued together in community. And listen, this was not a burden for them. This was a blessing. These were sweet times of fellowship and in the Lord. In verse 33, it says, these believers, these new converts, because they continued and because they were devoted to the things it says they were devoted to, it says that all came upon every soul, each and every soul, not just a select few. Every soul, all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. They continued and were committed to study God's word, and as they came together in community, the fellowship, God showed up. Where two or more are gathered, I am there with them, right? God showed up, and all came upon every soul. And the next thing we see, these new converts, these new believers did, was that they contributed. All of them, not just some of them. In verse 44, it says that all who believed, all those people were together and they had all things in common and they were selling their possessions and belongings and giving and distributing proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts. Now, just to clarify, this passage is not a call for communism or communal living, as some may suggest. What this passage is communicating is that these believers were so committed to the Lord and to one another as they continued, and so excited that the Lord Jesus Christ had saved them, and they were so grateful and they were so thankful and so in love with Jesus and the gospel and God's word and his church. They were so unified that they had all things in common, that they really were one big happy family. And when they saw their brother or sister in need, when they saw a ministry need, that need was met. That's what's communicated here. They took care of business, this family. They loved one another that much. And so there really were no needs when all was said and done. They loved each other and expressed that love in tangible ways. And they blessed one another, even made sacrifices for one another. And if they had the means to meet a need, they saw they did everything within their power to give and meet that need. That's generosity. That's what we see in this passage of Scripture. They even sold their stuff. Because now they had Jesus, that's all that it was to them, stuff. Their relationship with Jesus and their brothers and sisters in Christ was what they valued, and so even now, the new believers contributed, all of them. These new believers were generous, they gave. As they continued, they contributed, they were a part. They just didn't consume. They weren't like that slothful sloth that we saw just consuming last week in that video. No, they were there, though, consumed by the love of God and in awe of him. And therefore, they couldn't help but respond by giving and contributing themselves. Yeah, make no mistake about it. What we see in this passage are new believers, every believer living day by day, each and every day, not just on Sundays, each and every day in light of the gospel, not just for themselves. They stopped being about building their own kingdoms and they start being all about building the kingdom, God's kingdom. They sought first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things were added unto him. Matthew 6:33, they were truly worshiping God and they were generous. And you can't read this passage. I challenge you to read this passage and think that you can interpret it in any way other than these believers were blessed in living this way. They were not burdened. They were blessed by having this mentality of generosity. They were so blessed and excited. They were in awe of God. Each and every one of them, every soul, all came upon them. And the more they gave, God gave. And the more they poured themselves out, the Lord filled them up. And we see in verse 47 that day by day, as they continued, they were committed and in community together. And as they contributed day by day, verse 47, praising God continuously and having favor with all the people. No, they were not burdened. They were blessed. And look here, we're told that as they continued, in the manner that they continued, the work of God continued. We're told that the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Other men and women in their town, their neighbors, Men and women they lived next to, men and women who were watching them, people in their families, their literal biological brothers and sisters were watching them. The people that they worked with were watching them. People that they went to school with were watching them. And day by day, the Lord saved them because they saw the genuine and generous faith lived out by these believers. You better believe that their testimonies, the Lord used them as they continued to draw more men and women unto himself. You better believe that the community, the unbelieving community that was watching on was picking up what they were laying down. And the result was more. More for the glory of God. I mean, it's amazing to think about 3,000 people responding to the gospel, but it didn't stop there. Day by day, each and every day, more men and women, more mothers, more fathers, more sisters, more brothers coming to Christ. Day by day, the Lord added to their numbers those who were being saved from sin, death, and hell, and to life, and hope, and joy. And God let these people believe, these people who continued to be a part of that. What a blessing. Again, the point I hope we all see and are struck by is that these believers we see in this passage, new believers, mind you, they continued. And the question I ask you this morning, believers, is, are you? And if not, will you? And be blessed in the process. In the way we see illustrated here, that's spelled out for us in Acts chapter 2, mind you, purposefully by God. Nothing's in God's word by mistake or accident. This picture, this testimony is in there for a reason. God wants us to see this picture. This is the ideal. And the truth is, yes. Make no mistake about it, no ifs, ands, or buts. Following Jesus requires faith. It's not easy, but it's not a walk in a park, but it's worth it. Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And like we talked about last week, God wants you as you follow Jesus and on your journey with Jesus. God wants you to trust Jesus. God wants you to depend and lean on Jesus as you follow Jesus. So the question is, will you? The Great Commission of the Lord Jesus Christ, many of you are familiar with it. Matthew 28, 19 and 20. So many people leave off 20. Matthew 28, 19 says, go therefore. This charge is to every believer, every man, woman, boy, and girl who has responded to the gospel. This is the Great Commission of the Lord Jesus Christ. Go, be on mission for me. Go, don't just sit on the sidelines. Go, get your head in the game. Go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. There's no period there. There's a comma. This continues. Believers commissioned, we don't just baptize. We don't share the just share the gospel and baptize people. No, there's much more. We are to continue, verse 20, teaching them to observe or obey all that Jesus commanded. Please understand, Lifehouse Church, that God's call on my life personally is specific. It's defined. It's twofold. It's very clear. God has called me personally to boldly preach truth from his word, not my word, his word, and to shepherd and disciple people. In other words, to help people grow, to help people continue. And I want you to know that my heart is to be obedient to that call. And I want you to know that in the same way I have a heart for my kids, and in the same way you as parents have a heart for your kids to be all that they can be, to experience God's best and for them to grow and thrive and excel for the glory of God and to not miss out on a thing, but instead to make the most of every single opportunity that comes their way. I want you to know that as the pastor called by God here at Lifehouse Church, my burden is the same for each and every one of you. God has given me a heart for you, a deep desire to see you in the same way thrive and to see you grow and experience God in ways that you have not yet experienced God and grow. I don't want you to miss out, not one of you to miss out on a thing. I want you to take advantage of and not miss out on every opportunity that God offers us through Jesus for his glory, yes, but also for you, your good. I don't want you to be burdened. I want you to be blessed. That's what God wants for you. So why this generosity journey? Because this giving and generosity, this area specifically in our culture, so many believers in our culture, and for a plethora of reasons, an endless list of reasons, are simply unwilling or perhaps afraid, and they think that they are unable to pursue. And so they won't continue, or they can't continue, and so they don't. They think they can't. God's not okay with that because he wants more. He doesn't want his children to settle. He doesn't want you to settle. So again, giving and generosity is something that God wants for us. He wants his children to know and experience what Paul declared in Ephesians 3:20, the exceedingly abundantly above and beyond all that we might even ask or think. Is that your experience as you follow Christ? Are you experiencing exceedingly abundantly above and beyond all that we might ask or think? Sadly, I know the reality because I know many believers that the answer to that question is no. Many believers are frustrated. Many believers are struggling as they quote-unquote try to follow Jesus, and maybe you this morning are disillusioned and unmotivated and disengaged this morning. And if that's the case, there is a disconnect, but I assure you that the problem is not with God. The problem is with us. It's always with us. Jesus says in John 10:10 to you, each and every one of you, I have come, I am here. God sent me that you might have life, and not just life, abundant life. Jesus says in Matthew 11:28, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, all of you who are bearing heavy burdens, who are weighed down, and I will give you rest. Jesus tells us the truth. He wasn't trying to trick you and you give him your burden so he can put on a heavier burden. No, he says, I will give you rest. Come to me. Believer, you are meant to continue. You are meant to walk by faith. You are meant to trust Jesus. Know that a journey with Jesus ends or buts about it. Now listen, I wholeheartedly believe that generosity goes way beyond tithing and it goes way beyond specifically giving financially, but in our culture and context, I want you to know that's where it starts. That's where the journey of giving and generosity begins. So many pick and choose and they say, well, I give my time, and so you should. And so many people say, but I give my talent. I have a lot of talent, so I'm going to give my talent, and so you should. So many excuses. But you should never not give. You should give your treasure. I want you to know that I'm just shooting straight with you this morning, like I know that the apostles did to those new believers. Peter didn't water things down, and I don't want to water things down. I don't want to sugarcoat anything for you because I want the best for you. God wants the best for you. The believers in Acts chapter 2 were so hungry for truth and devoted. These new believers were desperate in a good way for more. And so Peter told them the truth. Likely he told them what Jesus said in Matthew 6:24, no one can serve two masters, not one person, no one, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. Jesus said, you cannot serve God and money, period. And you may say, and I hear this all the time from believers, well, Jesus doesn't say anything about tithing in the New Testament. Tithing's not even mentioned in the New Testament. That's an Old Testament concept. We are not to tithe. Jesus doesn't say anything about it. I hear that all the time. And my reply to you, if that's you, is what Jesus told the Sadducees in Matthew 22:29. You're wrong. You don't know the power of God because you don't know the scriptures. In the New Testament, Luke chapter 11, verse 42, Jesus confronting the Pharisees who were tithing. They were doing it. They were so careful to tithe the littlest amounts off of the herbs that they grew, but they weren't doing so with a legalistic mentality. They weren't doing so because they wanted to worship God or because they loved God. And so Jesus told those Pharisees, woe to you, Pharisees, for you tithe mint and rue and every herb and neglect the justice and love of God. And then Jesus said, these, tithing mint and rue and every herb, you ought to have done. Yes, Jesus told these Pharisees, you should be tithing. Yes, you should be tithing. These things you ought to have done. Jesus said it. He said, but without neglecting the others. The thing is, under the new covenant and in Christ, we're to go beyond tithing. We are to pursue giving and living generous lives that go way beyond legalistically tithing, beyond. Just to clarify what tithing is giving one-tenth of your increase or your increase of your income, your best, your first fruits, not your leftovers, everything that God has blessed you with, God has blessed you with, to the storehouse, which, and it's my conviction that the storehouse today is His church, the body of Christ. And without a doubt, regardless of where you are, what you give, believers, the thing is here, I'm not wanting you to feel guilty, I'm wanting you to feel motivated for wherever you are on that giving ladder, on that journey, my challenge to you is to continue. Take steps towards more, even if it's just baby steps, by the grace of God. This is something God wants for us. Malachi 3:10. God, through His prophet, tells His people, bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby, Almighty God says through His prophet, in this way, put me to the test. Test me, God says. And He says, see, if you test me in this way, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you, and see, if you test me in this way, if I will not pour out blessings upon you until there's no more need. This is the only time throughout Scripture that we are told to test God. In fact, other places, we're told that we should not put our Lord, our God, to the test. But God invites us in this one situation, in this one area, to put Him to the test. Because why? He wants you to experience Him. He wants you to know Him more. He wants to blow you away with His goodness. He wants to provide for you. He wants you to follow Him and trust Him each and every step of the way. He wants you to lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. He will bless you. That's His promise in this passage. And He says, believer, test me in this. I invite you to test me in this and watch me bless you. Watch me pour out my blessings upon you. Test me in this. Do you believe that He is who He claims to be? Almighty God, who sent His Son to die for you? Do you believe that He loves you? He proved that He sent Romans 5:8, Jesus, to die for you on a cross, even though you were still a sinner. You don't deserve what He did, but He loved you that much. He sent His Son to die for you. The Apostle Paul says in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now listen, I know you may be sitting in this auditorium and thinking, man, I'd love to do it, but there's just no way. It's impossible. But what I want to encourage you with this morning is that verse, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Oh, as Christians, we love that verse, don't we? We apply that verse when we're dieting, when we're working out, when we're at work. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. We love that verse, and that verse is truth. But what you may not understand or realize is the context in which Paul made that bold declaration. He made that declaration when he was talking about what we're talking about this morning. He was talking about how he knows how to survive and that God is faithful even in times of abundance and in times of great need, even in times when he went without food and that when he was hungry. And that's when, in that situation, he says, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And believer, I'm telling you, you can too. Now listen, I'm not making light of anyone's situation or circumstances. What I'm doing this morning is making much of our Almighty God, who is greater than your circumstances and who knows about your circumstances, who loves you, who knows the very number of hairs on your head, who has not forgotten you, and who will never, no, never, ever leave you or forsake you. That's the God that we serve. And He says, believer, loved by me, test me in this specific way and see if I will not bless you. Pour is a strong word. He says, pour out my blessings upon you. Bring it on, Lord. In closing, I have to share. Many of you women who went to the conference yesterday, will you raise your hands just so we can know? You got to meet Edwina Patterson. We go way back with Edwina. All right, and because she was here in the first service. Listen, I got her number. If you want confirmation that this story is true, I'll give it to you so you can call her. This story is true, and it involves generosity. Last week, I told you about when we were taken advantage of by a Christian brother who sold us a bus when we were in the ministry traveling in churches across the country, and he wanted to help us, and he sold us a bus so that we could take our kids with us, and it was a lemon. And at this time in our ministry, it was very hard. I'll tell you the truth. It was 10 weeks, or 10 years rather, of hard times and trusting God week by week by week. But God was faithful. And this specific week, we were getting ready for a ministry tour down in Alabama. And we were overwhelmed in every way, mentally, physically, and financially. Right before we left the trip, we paid for yet one more repair, and that left us literally with $400. That was it. And then we had some tithe money set aside in the bank. $400 might be enough to get us to Alabama, but it would not be enough to get us back. So we were discouraged. And so we kind of talked amongst ourselves. I mean, it was a ministry. We were going there to share the gospel. And so we kind of talked and said, hey, you know, this is ministry. So why don't we take that money that we set aside for tithe and why don't we use it for ministry expenses? That makes sense, right? We made our minds up. And so we actually decided to gather together before we did it as we, by the grace of God, we gathered together and we prayed. And it didn't make sense to us, but God told us no. Don't do it. Tithe. Give. And so it seemed foolish. But by the grace of God, and I'm not here to boast about it, I just want to share with you because I want you to experience God in the way that by His grace we have been experiencing Him by living according to these truths. By His grace, we wrote the check, we sent the tithe out. The bank account was zero. We had $400 to our name, and we set out for Alabama, literally. We were empty, zero in our bank account. We were driving through the night to get there. About 2 o'clock in the morning, I look in the rearview mirror. There was flames coming out from under the bus. Abby and Hudson were babies at the time. Tammy, my wife, was pregnant at the time. I was angry. I pulled off at the very next exit and into a parking lot. And it wasn't until I got into the parking lot and I looked at the sign, it was a XXX nightclub. I was angry. God, really? Our bank account was zero. We were in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the night. I was done. Rob was done. We quit the ministry that night. We were done. We were going to find a mechanic to come fix our bus, and we were going home. We weren't going to Alabama. So we looked through the yellow pages. We finally woke a guy up who was not happy about it. He agreed to come fix our bus, and so we waited there. And wouldn't you know it, Edwina was coincidentally in Delaware with Tammy's mother, Janet. And of course, we were calling home, especially the girls, crying, please help us, we don't know what to do. And so Edwina called Tammy on the phone to encourage and pray with her. After Tammy got off the phone, she relayed Edwina's prayer to us. And there were four things that Edwina prayed for specifically. One was that we would see where we were in the middle of the night, in the middle of nowhere, in a XXX nightclub parking lot as a divine appointment. She prayed that the mechanic who was coming on his way to fix our bus would fix our bus, that he would give us a good deal. And Edwina prayed that that mechanic would give us money back. Okay, we know that Edwina was sincere, but we were cynical at the time, and we just kind of moved on. Okay, whatever, Edwina, I say with all respect. So the guy, long story short, he fixed our bus. We didn't really talk to him much. Hours went by. He literally had to drive an hour to pick up a part and an hour back. Anybody knows how mechanics works, auto shops? We didn't even know this guy. I, as an accountant, have an accounting degree. I could just hear the cash register adding up all the numbers as each minute ticked by. I just was preparing myself for this invoice that we didn't have the money to pay that he was going to hand us. And he was writing out the invoice, and he handed me the invoice, and it was $317, which that in itself was a miracle. I'm telling you, this was emergency roadside assistance. This was hours. He drove an hour to get a part and an hour back. That in itself was a miracle. So I was excited. I got on the bus. We had $400. I took the $317, went out, handed it to him gladly. And he said, you know what? Are you guys Christians? I was surprised to know that he, because we weren't acting very Christ-like during that time. Again, we were angry. I said, well, as a matter of fact, we are. And he said, you know what? I'm a Christian. And he said, I think this morning was a divine appointment. And then that mechanic took $20 from the money that I just handed him and gave it back to me. And he said, I want to sow seed into your ministry. Remember the four things Edwina prayed for? divine appointment, he would come fix her bus, he would give us a good deal, and that he would give us money back. Has any mechanic ever given you money back? So we rejoined the ministry. That was enough for us, right? We did. Hey, the story's not over. I can't see Janet. Are you here in the back? Okay. So we rejoined the ministry. We were encouraged on our way to Alabama. And Janet, that same day, this all started at 2:00 in the morning. That same day, Janet, it was picking up our mail for us. And she was going through the different mail, the envelopes that we had received, and she said that we got this letter from a lady named Faye Parker in Glen Burnie, Maryland. This day, we don't know who she is. Never met her, still have never met her. And so we were curious. We asked Janet to open the envelope to tell us what was inside. Janet, can you tell them what was inside that envelope? Can you hear? It was a check for $317. Who writes a check for $317? Why not 320, right? Why not 300? It would have been enough. We would have been excited. 317. Lifehouse Church, child of God, this is the exceedingly abundantly above and beyond all that we might ask or think. This is God putting us to the test. I kid you not, one of the last things we did before we head to Alabama, and listen, we weren't even happy about it. We wrote our tithe check. We sent that check. And God poured out his blessings upon us. That whole trip to Alabama and then into Georgia, it was the most blessed ministry trip that we had ever experienced, exceedingly abundantly above and beyond all that we might ask or think. And my burden for you is that I want you to have those experiences. My kids, I want you to have those experiences. I want you to trust God, and I want you to give and live a generous life so that you can experience God and not be frustrated and disengaged and disconnected. I want you to be connected. I want you to be excited because you are experiencing God in a way that he wants you to experience him. So will you continue? The choice is yours. His arms are open. He has invited you, each and every one of you, to test him in this specific area. And he has promised, if you do, I will pour out my blessing. You'll see. See. Watch. Listen, I know that there are more testimonies just like mine. And listen, before God, even though I'm an accountant, have an accounting degree, Tammy and I have not always made the wisest choices with our finances. We've made dumb decisions. We're living and learning just like you. I remember one time we bought an industrial-sized water filter for our little town home. It cost us thousands of dollars. This water filter was enough for this whole school building, and it filled up a whole closet in our little townhouse. Dumb. But before God, one thing that I do not and will never, no, never, ever regret is one penny that by the grace of God, Tammy and I have had and been blessed to sow into the kingdom of God. And before God, I'm telling you, and I'm just shooting straight with you, if given the opportunity, if God was standing before me and said, Mark, I'll give it all back to you, every penny right now. You don't have to give me your tithe. I would say, no, keep it, God. I wouldn't trade one experience that we've had. And listen, it's not been easy. I'm 43. Just paid off my student loans this year. But I'm telling you, I feel rich. I am blessed. I am thankful. And I am experiencing God in exceedingly abundantly above and beyond ways that I've never even dreamed of. And I am thankful. And it is only by his grace. And Lifehouse Church, I want that so much for each and every one of you. And I want our community, our neighbors, our brothers and sisters, and our moms and our dads, and the people that we work with, I want them to see us living out our faith and our lives in exceedingly abundantly above and beyond ways, and them saying, I want what he's got. I want God to use my testimony. He has been generous.
will you be? Man, in Acts 2, we see the people of God continuing. And as they continued in the way they continued, God's work continued. And day by day, the Lord added to their number people who were being saved. That's what I want to see here. Do you? As we bring it to a close, I just want to challenge you. We're going to take 30 seconds of silence. And I want to ask you, men and women of God, meant to continue, meant to follow, meant to trust God, meant to seek God and obey God, I'm going to ask you, I don't want you to hear from me, I want you to hear from God, and I want you to ask God right now how you can express generosity for His glory over this time. Pray for this. Pray for that offering on November 8th, and pray that as we go out into our community that God uses that to bring glory to Himself. Lord, we want to see Your glory. That's what we want to see. How will you continue? Maybe you haven't been continuing. Now it's time to start. Let's pray. Bow our heads and pray.